My name is Tara Clark, and I'm going to tell you about what you could do with a focus ion beam. You're going to see that you can use it for complex patterning, for making site-specific SEM cross-sections, and if you decided you wanted to look at it in the TEM after that, you could pull a thin slice out for TEM. And you can also use it for doing serial sectioning, so you can see the three-dimensional structure. It's an extension to the SEM. It's a vacuum-based technique, so you can have your sample, so it's either perpendicular to the SEM coming down here or perpendicular to the ion beam. And it's just a scanning ion microscope. Since ions are heavier than electrons, they actually end up blasting material away. So if you could just control where you scanned, you could actually do site-specific sputtering or deposition. This is what it looks like on the inside. The SEM comes out of here, the FIB comes down here. You put your sample on a top of a stub, conventional SEM stub, and imagine that you wanted to image a sphere. You could image it with either beam. If you wanted to coat the sample with a metal or an insulator, you could do that as well. And lastly, if you wanted to pick that sphere up and move it around, you could do that with the manipulator. As I mentioned, you can do prototyping. And here's an example. This is a fluidic building block in glass. And in this case, someone wanted to know if you inject two fluids in here and in here, how long does it take for them to be fully mixed? So as you can see, the first thing that they did is they deposited a trench that's more than a micron and a half deep. And they also wanted to study the effective temperature. So they deposited platinum electrodes in the meander so that way they could do localized heating. A device like this can be done in less than 10 minutes. We spend most of our time, however, doing cross-sectioning. And that's a case where you have some kind of feature that's on the surface that you see it with the SEM. And you want to know, is that from something that reacted below the surface? Or is that just like a piece of dirt? Usually, if you had an image like this and just an SEM, you wouldn't be able to tell. But if you had a FIB, you could tilt your sample so it's perpendicular to the ion beam, remove a triangular wedge of material like you see here, and now you've exposed what's beneath the surface, and you can image it with the SEM. This is an example where that was useful. This is a electrical contact, and a colleague, she looks at these thin film contacts. She wants to know, how do they fail? So what she does is she deposits her thin films in round pads like this using lithography. Then she puts a thin a probe on top. You can see some of the scratches here. And she puts one at the bottom of the substrate that you can't see. And she passes a high enough current that it becomes an open circuit. And then she wants to know, well, what happened to my thin film contact layers? So as you can imagine, she's going to remove one of these wedges that we talked about here. So the first thing you do is you deposit a protective layer with tungsten or some kind of metal. And then you cut. And now you've exposed what's beneath the surface. Here's the edge of one of those contact pads. When we cross-sectioned a pad that had not been stressed, this is what it looks like. Here's the substrate, silicon carbide, the individual contact layers, and then a gold layer on top. But when you stress it, as you can see here, the layers have reacted with one another and the gold becomes porous. If we wanted to, we could map this image according to elements. So we could show where's the silicon, the carbon, the gold, the other elements. But sometimes someone wants to map, or they need to map, or we want to know the crystal structure. I mean, when they have questions like that, then we end up having to make a sample for TEM. The good news is we're halfway there because we already have this plane here. So if we put another triangular trench in the back, rotate it 180 degrees, and we could pull it out and put it in the TEM. This is the process of us doing that. First, again, you put a protective layer in, triangular trench in the front, back. This is looking at it at an angle, 52 degrees. It's about 2 microns thick here, but we need to get this out of the substrate, otherwise we'll never be able to load it in the TEM. So we need to pull out this membrane. So you put a U-shaped trench here, it's still fastened on the side. We fasten it to a needle, we lift it out. It's 10 microns from here to here, which is too small for us to handle by hand, so we have to put it on something larger, which is what you see here. This is half of a copper disc that's been machined in this shape. It's being held in the jaws of a vise. And it's 3 millimeters from here to here. we can handle things from 3 millimeters. And in fact, this membrane is this bright spot that you see here, which I've blown up here. So we deposit some material to fasten the membrane to the pulse, cut off the needle, take the needle away, and then we use the ion beam from the top in the front and in the back to make the sample thinner. And where you see it's bright, now it's thin enough that we can answer those questions we talked about. Is it crystalline? Is it amorphous? What's the chemical state? Where are the elements? All of those. For a typical sample, it takes about 3 hours to do this. And then we can put it in the TEM and we can observe the internal structure. And this is a field effect transistor where you're able to see all the different layers. This is done by lithography as well, a lot of steps. And with, if you don't do TEM, you will not be able to see it. Another question that comes up when somebody sees a image like this is they look at the pores and they want to know the size and the shape of the pores. Now, one of the reasons you can do that is because once you have a cross-section like this, you can then use the ion beam to remove another slice, collect another image with the SEM like this, remove another slice, and just keep going back and forth. I want to show you an example where that was useful. I have another colleague who looks at multi-layer capacitors, and what he wants to know is, a capacitor you may know has two electrodes, positive and negative, both metals, and separated by a dielectric. And he knew that he had pores in the electrodes. He didn't want the pores, but he knew that they were there. So he wanted to know the size and the shape so that way he can model the performance. So as you can see, what he did is he used the ion beam to remove a slice and then collected an image almost perpendicular to that plane with the SEM and then removed another slice. So here are the images that he got. The light gray layers are the metal electrodes. Notice how the pores come and go, which reveals they do not go all the way through the length of the sample. But since we know the thickness of each slice, we can then put these images back together to reconstruct the three-dimensional volume. And then we can crop in the horizontal direction so that way we can see the size and the shape of the pores. This work took about 4 hours. So before I close, I want to tell you, I just want to summarize some of the advantages and disadvantages of using the FIB. It allows you to modify or deposit on any solid, including frozen samples, so even frozen liquids. You can do complex patterning, you can cross-section, do site-specific sample prep, as well as get the 3D structure by serial sectioning. There are disadvantages. One is there are limits in the size of features that you can pattern. One, the smallest you can do is about 3 nanometers, and that's it has to be very shallow. And as far as the largest, at least with a gallium-based FIB, it's about a millimeter. And it cannot be deep for that. So if you wanted it to be deep, it's about 100 microns, 100 microns by 100 microns. In addition to that, it does damage any surface that is scanned, which I almost didn't put this one in there, but because of course it damages, it better damage, you want it to damage. But for some samples, that's not acceptable, and we have ways to work around that. And there are challenging samples like heterogeneous or porous phases. We have ways to get around these, some of them, but they can be tough. And lastly, if we have to do high aspect ratio trenches, those are difficult as well. We cannot go infinitely deep. It would neck off the bottom. Here are some typical applications. And honestly, it's hard to find a field where you can't use this because there are many times where you just want to see the beneath the surface and the FIB allows you to do that. And the specs. I shared 3 nanometers. Typical cross sections are between 8 and 30 microns wide, about 10 microns deep. We can do any solid, including frozen liquids. It takes between 1 and 5 hours per sample. You can, after you've made a cross section, you can look at it with EDS or EBSD, provided that it has the right geometry. And in our lab, we have other capabilities in the FIB and the SEM, including in situ heating, cooling, biasing, and straining. And lastly, the sample has to be vacuum compatible. Thank you.